We begin our final approach to Shor's algorithm coming up next week. In preparation for that, our magic word this week is Fourier. Fourier series, Fourier transforms, and the varieties of these categories: real, complex, continuous, discrete, fast, and for us, the inevitable, quantum. The quantum Fourier transform, or QFT, is our endgame this week, and it's the last of four very substantial preparatory lessons in Fourier theory. But most of you will only need to read about 1.5 of the next 4 chapters, and that's okay. Your roadmap is in the usual place, and it'll help you decide which sections of which chapters are best for your unique background. This first installment is about Fourier series, sums of sines and cosines. All the key ideas of Fourier theory are present in Fourier series, so I'm asking you to spend about 30 minutes reading a few sections here in this one, just to get a feel for those ideas. Then you can go on to one or more of the next 3 chapters. Fourier series only work with periodic functions like tan x, or functions that have a compact domain like x squared, defined only between -1 and 1. So we'll review or define those categories first. If we do have a periodic function, though, we'll pick one domain interval like -1 to 1, or 0 to 2 pi, to be its so-called fundamental interval over which it doesn't really look periodic. It's actually the replication of the function's behavior from this interval to all real numbers that gives the function periodicity. Next comes the big news. Any function that falls in the category I just described can be written as a sum of sines and cosines. To truly grasp the wonder and irony of this fact, take a simple function like f of x equals x, considered either as having compact support between minus pi and pi, or as a periodic function that replicates its graph from that section to the entire real line. As you can see, this function's graph has absolutely zero curvature compared to the voluptuous sines and cosines, so how do we get it as such a sum? The main Fourier theorem will tell us, but skipping over that detail for now, we're happy to look at and ponder the answer. We can see that it takes infinitely many smooth sinusoidal terms to get them to add up to the strange, linear, and jagged sawtooth shape. I called it ironic because we're staring at a nice, simple function, f of x equals x, and asking to get it as an infinite sum of trig functions. Why do that? We explain it later in the chapter. Accepting that reality for the moment, we stand back and look at what it all means. We start out with a function that can be practically anything within reason and end up with the sum of sines and cosines. For different functions, we get different sums. But they're always built up from those exact same sines and cosines. The only things that change from function to function are the coefficients of those curvy building blocks, the two sequences a sub n and b sub n. This all defines a mapping from continuous functions defined on some compact interval, functions like f of x equals x, e to the x, or x cubed minus log x, to discrete sequences a sub n and b sub n. Again, we have a mapping from continuous functions to discrete sequences. The a sub n and b sub n are collectively called the Fourier coefficients. They tell us how much of each specific sine or cosine we need in our recipe to build the original f. Some functions require a large dose of, say, sine x or cosine 2x to make the sum come out right, while other functions need larger doses of sine 20x or cosine 600x. The former sinusoids are considered low-frequency components, and the latter are called high-frequency components. If the function we're trying to build has a lot of squiggling going on, we'll need larger doses of the high frequencies. Their coefficients will be larger. If the function is very slow-moving, we'll need larger doses of the low frequencies. This is an oversimplification and has to be qualified with many details that you'll read about, but that's the big idea. Here's part of a graph of the first 25 coefficients for the function f of x equals x. All these a sub n's and b sub n's taken together make up the so-called spectrum of the function. If we have the function, we can find the spectrum. If we have the spectrum, we can build the function. Each half gives a different view of the same entity. The sum may be infinite, but we can stop at any point and get a finite approximation to f. You can see how the further we take the sum, the better approximation we get to our desired function. A worthwhile variation of Fourier series for us is the complex form, which uses exponentials instead of sinusoids as the pure frequencies out of which we build functions. The way to understand this is by remembering the close connection between sinusoids and exponentials, Euler's formula. If we start with that and make a few substitutions, we arrive at the complex form. The advantage is that it has a nice compact expression, and it also sets up the Fourier transform coming next chapter. Oh, and I seem to recall promising you a way to compute the sequence of a sub n's and b sub n's given the original function. Here's the formula for the real Fourier series, and here's the one for the complex series. These formulas tell us how to generate any one of the coefficients using the function as a starting point. Meditate on this. It tells us how to reconstruct the function from the Fourier coefficients and how to build the coefficients from the function. The longer you stare at it, the more you'll see. We'll develop its beauty next time.